Hello, everyone. Welcome to our series of lectures on FNMI education. I'm going to give you today, begin with a brief background on Aboriginal policy in Canada. This front slide here depicts a kind of a spectrum of policy that we're going to inspect throughout history in Canada. On the left side, you'll see the big word assimilation, and on the right side, you'll see the word parallelism. These are the two extremes of Aboriginal policy in Canada, and as with most things, the happy middle ground is the best place to be. But we'll just see how divisive and punishing Aboriginal policy has been. And then think about this. Think about this as a background for what we learn about FNMI education, First Nations, Métis, Inuit education in Canada. All these different policies have had their major effects on Aboriginal education in Canada. So feel free to come back to that slide now and again and inspect it and see where on the spectrum the various policies lie. And then think on your own about how these different policies have affected education in, for Native people in Canada. Okay. So, part one here of this series, I'd like to first of all introduce you to a series of terms. Some basic terms that maybe we take for granted what they mean. Maybe we haven't really put a lot of thought into what they mean. Some words we use hurt, others heal. Some words have etymological roots that means quite a different thing than the way we use it. Some words have a kind of a political meaning. They can be used as weapons and tools to vie for more power, to take power away from another group, that sort of thing. We're going to look at that today. The first term that I'd like to investigate with you is the term Aboriginal. Now, this is a term that comes from Latin, and it literally means ab origine, which means like from the beginning, right? Defined in the Constitution of 1982, this word is used to refer to three groups of people in Canada: Inuit people, Indian people, and Métis people. So they're Section 35(2) of the Canadian Constitution Act from 1982 there, see? But it's a funny word, isn't it? From the beginning, because, I mean, we know what it means. We know it refers to these three groups of people, but at the same time, there's also a certain way in which the word Aboriginal does not quite connote, or maybe connotes more than the historical truth. Like Aboriginal people were certainly here before all the other peoples, but they weren't here since the beginning. History shows that, or prehistory, I guess, shows that everybody that came here tens of thousands of years ago actually came over on the Bering Strait, right? So came over from Asia. So this is a powerful word. It has a legal meaning, it has an etymological meaning, and then we have to understand the ways in which these words are used in a modern day context. Okay, another word or phrase that you're bound to come across is the phrase indigenous peoples. So the word indigenous, again, another Latin word, just means native to or belonging naturally to. So it's the original people in any region of the planet. So again, original has a different flavor than first people. Original seems to suggest that people are actually, there ever since the inception, ever since the beginning of things. Or it just might mean that you're born, that you're native to this place. And then so again, right, like apart from those of us who immigrated here in this generation, us, most people, I mean, everyone else was born here, right? So in a certain way, we also are indigenous or native to Canada. But understand that the word doesn't mean that when it's used to refer to native people. It means it has a specific meaning that we always need to associate with native people. The word, actually, there's a kind of a power behind this sense, indigenous people. It's not something that is solely spoken of in native thought or indigenous thought. It's actually goes back to the Greeks. Autochthones, right? The Greek word autos or autos, meaning self, and kathon or soil. So people actually sprung from the earth itself. There is a kind of a mythic sense or a mythic underpinning to this sense of indigenous peoples, right? The people of the land, the people, like the Inuit actually means the people, right? So, you know, these are ideas deeply steeped in myth. You know, with the Greeks, they even had a myth about the Spartans, and that the Spartans were actually people who sprung up out of the earth itself in the area of the world where they lived. They were sown there from dragon's teeth, right? So this idea of autochthonous beginnings is part of Western civilization. It's also part of indigenous peoples and civilization as well. So it's an all-inclusive term, though. This is another thing. It's used to speak about Aboriginal people in an international context, right? So whereas when you see the word Aboriginal people in Canada, it refers to one of those, or one or more, all three of those groups. Indigenous peoples, actually, the grouping is much more extensive. It encompasses indigenous peoples all around the world, okay? Okay, the word native as well. We talked a little bit about this just now, from the Latin natio, birth or origin. It's related to nativus, as having arisen by birth, also suggesting original, right? So again, you know, you or I, if we were born in Canada, well, we're native Canadians. We were born here from birth or from our origins. But that's not the way that the word is nowadays used. We don't say, I'm a native Canadian, unless, of course, I'm Aboriginal in some fashion, right? So the term is used synonymously for all Aboriginal peoples in Canada who are Inuit or Indian. It's used to refer to people who were living in Canada prior to the arrival of Europeans. And I don't know, I mean, you can ask different people who are native Canadians, you know, do they mind this term? I've actually met people who don't like the word native because they associate it with kind of a derogatory way in which sometimes people speak of, you know, some native person that is suffering in the city and maybe homeless or something like that. Or so you have to, when we use these terms, you also have to understand, like, find out what people are most comfortable with, word associations are implicated in the way that you know a word is used. Some people will find this word fine, some people will not find this word okay. Okay, then the word Indian. This is the trickiest one. It's a common misnomer applied to the original people throughout the Americas. The term was used by Christopher Columbus when he arrived in the New World, thinking he had arrived on the shores of India. So I took that as a direct quotation out of that book, Education is Our Buffalo. It's a really good teacher resource for you in your own classroom. It made me wonder, though. I've always wondered about that. Because, I mean, Christopher Columbus, here was this guy. He was, you know, he's an explorer. Kind of brave in a way, right? He goes off, doesn't know whether where he's going to end up. But always, it was a little bit fishy to me that he thought that he'd landed in India. It's not like nobody had ever been to India before or known what India looked like. And so, I mean, I I did a little bit of research around on this, and so it turns out, here's a picture of the oldest surviving terrestrial globe. It's by this Martin Behaim from 1492, so just around the time or just before Columbus's voyage. And on these ancient globes, or not ancient globes, on these globes from this period of time, Asia was, India was essentially everything that was Asia, right? So Columbus, in other words, didn't think he was going to India, he thought he was going to Asia. And that's the term that he used, when he thought that he had sailed, because he thought the world was round, right? A lot of people didn't, but he supposedly did, so he figured just go around it, and there you go, you're in Asia. He didn't know that there was a whole other continent, all right? So that's a little bit that I found out about that back in the day when I was researching this. And then, I don't know, one of the things that I always liked, I don't know if you guys ever liked George Carlin or you appreciate George Carlin's humor. He's one of the great stand-up comics of the 20th century. He does a fair number of rants or monologues. And there's this one, I'm going to just read it to you because it kind of stuck with me the first time I heard it. He says, I call them Indians because that's what they are. They're Indians. There's nothing wrong with the word Indian. First of all, it's important to know that the word Indian does not derive from Columbus mistakenly believing he had reached India. India was not even called the name in 1492. It was known as Hindustan. More likely, the word Indian comes from Columbus's description of the people he found here. He was an Italian and he didn't speak or write very good Spanish, so in his written accounts, he called the Indians una gente in Dios, a people in God, in Dios, Indians, right? It's a perfectly noble and respectable word. Well, when I heard that, when I heard Carlin say that, I was like, wow, that's pretty cool, right? I mean, then it's not this derogatory word at all, is it? And then, you know, since then, found out there's similar claims made by a number of Native American activists. This fellow Bearhart in this book makes this claim as well. So then I brought it one time. I was teaching at this girls' school for grade 5? And they were studying Canadian history. And I brought that story forward to them when we were talking about Native peoples, because some of them brought up the word Indian. And I said, what do you think of that? And they held that, and they thought that was a good possibility. But then they started to wonder, one of the girls put up her hand, and she says, you know, even if that's true, you know, that you know, Columbus saw these people and said that they were a people in God, which sounds like a good thing, he sure didn't treat them that way, right? How would you treat folks you held to be a people in God? And I thought that was a really good point. It makes you suspicious of Carlin's account, even though it sounds really well-researched or something, right? There's a book that I love to do with students. It's called Encounter. It's by Jane Yolen. I don't know if you've ever seen it before. You can probably get it at the public library or something like that. You can get it online on Amazon, too. It's very good, though. It's about first contact. Columbus and his men come across the sea, and everybody meets them, and everybody seems to be in some way duped by the image of this man, except this one little child, and the little child is warning everybody about the danger that this man has brought into their midst. And you can see, right, how there's this underlying greed, the way that he's looking at the gold there in that one picture. And so it's really interesting, and in a way, it you know, even again, like, even if Carlin were correct about the term Indian and etymologies leading to this word, you know, stemming from Indios or una gente in Dios, you know, the story itself seems kind of to not fit the facts. So, pressed a little bit further into this, because the word Indian is kind of interesting to me, right? this fellow David Wilton published this book a few years ago. David Wilton noted in his book Word Myths, Debunking Linguistic Urban Legends, this phrase does not appear in any of Columbus's writings. Wilton also says that since Greek and Roman times, more than a millennium before the voyages of Columbus, many European languages used variations of the term Indian to describe the peoples of the Indian subcontinent. So just what I was saying, right? Like the Far East, Asia, the word India was in wider use than what Carlin suggests. Here's a direct quote out of his book, actually. Now, Carlin is a very funny comedian, but he's a poor etymologist. The word India has been in English use since the 9th century. It's from the Latin, name for the land, which in turn is from Greek, and ultimately from the Persian, hind, and the Sanskrit, Sindhu, meaning river, specifically the Indus River. Alexander the Great in the 3rd century BC referred to the Indus River and called the inhabitants of the region Indicoi, right? Maps that predate Columbus's 1492 voyage label the land Indi. So, there you go. The word Hindustan, or more accurately, Indostan, to use the early spelling, on the other hand, didn't enter the common European use until the 17th century. So if Columbus were to use a name for that land, it would be India, not Hindustan. The use of the adjective Hindu in European languages is even a bit later, dating to the late 17th century. So what does all this mean? It means, on the one hand, it wasn't... I guess it means that Columbus wasn't being as... he wasn't being as positive in his remarks as Carlin is making out, but nor was he as big of a dummy as perhaps some people say, you know, that he's supposed to have actually landed in India, the country of India. It's actually more like he thought he had circumvented the globe and come around and discovered a new route to Asia. Okay? So there you go. A little bit of fact-finding for you. Okay, so the word Indian, actually, we should not use that word anymore when we refer as to people who are Native Canadian or Aboriginal Canadian or First Nations people, Inuit, right? Métis, any of these groups, we should not use that word. Understand that the word Indian still is in existence in parlance, mainly because it's a legal term now, okay? It's part of the Indian Act of Canada, which includes a legal definition of what an Indian means, all right? So it's a legal term. It's used in law books. Otherwise, it's derogatory. It's not to be used by non-native people. It's only available for use in non-legalistic everyday language use for people who are in that particular group. So if Native people wish to call one another or refer to themselves as Indian, then that's okay, obviously, right? But one who's outside or stands outside of that particular group ought not to use that word, so... understand that. The rule of thumb here, ladies and gentlemen, is just call people by the name they wish to be called. Okay, but what about this word, phrase, status Indians, right? This is another legal term. Aboriginal people in Canada who are classified as status Indians are registered under the Indian Act on the Indian Register. This is a central registry maintained by Indian and Northern Affairs Canada. Status Indians are issued a status card that contains information about their identity, their band, and their registration number. And the Indian Act only applies to status Indians, and it didn't historically recognize Métis and Inuit people. As a result, the Métis and Inuit have not had Indian status and the rights conferred by this status despite being Indigenous to Canada. Do you see the messy mess this is? The Indian Act has historically stated that those with Indian status have rights to live on reserves, share in band monies, vote for band council and chief, and inherit band property. Now, in 1985, an amendment to the Indian Act separated Indian status from band membership. Bands were granted the right to develop their own membership codes and thereby determine who can participate in band politics and society, as well as who can access band resources such as band property. Bands, however, did not have control over who gained or lost status. This power was retained by the federal government. You can ask, is that a good or a bad thing that the federal government maintained the ability and it wasn't given to the bands to decide who gained or lost status? You could argue either way, and there are people that actually do. While band membership frequently accompanies Indian status, it's possible to have Indian status without having band membership or vice versa. It's very confusing. The Indian Act contains certain tax exemptions for those with Indian status, though there is a misconception, and this is a misconception, folks, that Indians do not pay taxes at all. Okay? Of course Native people pay taxes. This is inaccurate. When off-reserve lands, general Canadian taxation applies. Certain tax exemptions exist on reserve lands. These tax exemptions generally stem from treaty and related agreements between the Crown and First Nations. When the Crown guaranteed particular services in exchange for title to land. Those with Indian status do not pay taxes for most purchases on reserve lands. If their property is located on reserve lands, that property is tax exempt. Those with Indian status who are employed on reserve lands or whose businesses are located on reserve lands may be exempt from some income and business taxes, but the provisions governing these exemptions are complex and do not uniformly apply in every scenario. Okay, so just be wary, folks, of the sorts of things that people say ignorantly about, you know, how those Native people, they don't pay taxes and all this stuff, and how they got it so good. Well, you know, be careful, because actually you're going to hear, especially if you teach high school too, you're going to hear a lot of rubbish like that in your classes. Kids are going to come there with certain misconceptions about, Native people and paying taxes and these sorts of things. And if you know something about it, you can help set them straight on this, right? They get this from their parents mostly, folks. People's misconceptions in your classes come from kind of deep-seated ignorance about Native people. Okay, here's some commentary from the First Nations Studies program at UBC about this. There are complex rules governing Indian status, which are detailed in Section 6 of the Indian Act. Indian status has not been solely dependent on ancestry. That's interesting, hey? As the Royal Commission of Aboriginal Peoples stated, recognition as Indian in Canadian law often had nothing to do with whether a person was actually of Indian ancestry. The Indian Act of 1867 defined Indian as, first, any male person of Indian blood reputed to belong to a particular band, all right? Second, any child of such a person. Or third, any woman who is or was lawfully married to such a person. So in other words, you could marry in to Indian status. So if you were a non-Native woman and you were to marry a Native man, you would gain Indian status, okay? So, excuse me. As this excerpt states, being Indian was entirely dependent on the male lineage. This privileging of the male lineage in order to define Indian status has resulted in profound gender equalities. Now, this is an interesting thing, too, because, you know, you hear how you know, in many native societies, the lines, lineages, family lineages weren't patrilineal but matrilineal, meaning that they followed the woman, not the man's descendants and children. So it's kind of backwards the way that the government has set things up in the Indian Act, isn't it? A woman's status depended upon her father or husband, and could change throughout her life. For example, this gets confusing, a woman without Aboriginal ancestry marrying a man with Indian status would gain Indian status. Alternately, if a status Indian woman married a non-status man, she would lose status or become enfranchised. Now, that's a wild thing too, right? Notice how when you, like you or I, when we think of enfranchisement, we think, oh, that's awesome, getting enfranchised. You get the vote, right? People fought wars and, you know, court battles and, you know, many heads were smashed in getting the right to vote over the centuries. But here, enfranchisement is almost, it's like the loss of your status. It's the loss of your identity, your Indian identity. But with that loss, they say, and congratulations, here's your right to vote. And now you have become absorbed into the greater Canadian society, and you are no longer anything but Canadian, you see. So anyway, these provisions have resulted in social and political conditions that have disproportionately discriminated against Indian women and have been challenged in the last few decades of the 20th century. As a result of major pressure on the Canadian government to address the discriminatory practices of the Act, the definition of Indian status has undergone significant revisions since 1985 with Bill C-31. That's a pretty important bill, folks. Historically, the government also outlined how one may lose Indian status and become a full Canadian citizen. The process of losing one's Indian status for citizenship rights was called enfranchisement. You know, you'd figure that enfranchisement would be a gain, which it is, but it's a weird, it's like a Pyrrhic victory, eh? I mean, you gain this, but what do you trade for it? You trade your heritage, right? You trade. So it's a very strange notion when it's applied to in the Indian context. Initially, any Indians who obtained a university degree and or became a professional, such as a doctor or lawyer, would automatically lose their status. Like, that's wild, right? Here you are, you're a native person. The moment you accomplish anything, it's like, oh, well, you can't, you're not allowed to be classified as Indian anymore. The same process would occur for any Indian who served in the armed forces, or any status Indian woman who married a non-status man. When a woman was enfranchised, as with any enfranchised Indian, she was not provided with compensation or support, nor could she be guaranteed access to her community of origin, since her band membership would have been removed as well. Essentially, she lost her Indian rights. Strange notion of enfranchisement, isn't it? Doesn't it sound like the opposite in a way? Of course, once someone had lost their status or was enfranchised, they were unable to pass along Indian status, right? You have native blood. But, you know, one of these situations happens where you lose your Indian status. Now the line is broken, not just for you, but for your children and your children's children, right? Thus severing ties to their ancestry and community, their Indian ancestry was no longer legally recognized, and in many cases they were further separated from their communities physically, geographically, socially, spiritually, psychologically, and emotionally. So a long fight and staunch opposition to these policies by women who had lost their status resulted in the passing of Bill C-31 to amend the Indian Act. It's now impossible for a status Indian to lose his or her status, and those who had involuntarily lost their status were able to be reinstated with it. These amendments, however, have not entirely remedied the discriminatory history, as descendants of women who have lost their status continue to face challenges. Therefore, amendments to the Indian Act regarding status continue to be challenged and revised. So, I mean, let's deepen this story a bit more here now. So what is this Bill C-31 Indian classification? When people talk about that, what are they talking about? Well, here's a quote right from Education is Our Buffalo on this subject. A person who has regained or gained status as a registered Indian under the terms of the Indian Act after the passage of Bill C-31 in the Canadian Parliament in 1985. That's what Bill C-31 Indian is. Prior to Bill C-31, women who married men not considered Indian under the Indian Act were taken off the Indian register and lost all their rights as Indians. These women took their cause for reinstatement to the United Nations and eventually to the Supreme Court of Canada. The court decided against them by one vote, but advised the Canadian government to correct and change the discriminatory section of the Indian Act, and Parliament passed Bill C-31 in 1985. So I'd like to unpack that a little bit, because there's a lot that actually happens there that we haven't discussed. So a little bit of information about these court cases that were mentioned in Education is Our Buffalo, and also how Bill C-31 was a tool designed by the government to bring the Indian Act in line with the Equality Rights section of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. I mean, don't forget, and we'll get to this too in one of the other lectures, but the Charter of Rights and Freedoms came in 1982. Bill C-31 came in 1985. And so Bill C-31 is part of basically a long process that happened not just in Native policy, but in all different government policies, and ever since then, even now, right? Whenever you make a law in Canada, or whether it's a federal law or a provincial law or even a municipal law, right? These things need to be aligned with the charter. They need to be what's called charter-proofed, or they need to... they need to be charter perfect, right? Do the laws that you make align with the values that are stipulated as the values of Canadian citizens in the charter? Okay, so that's what this was about. Obviously, they were looking at the Indian Act, and they were saying there's something that's fishy about this, that it's discriminatory against women in particular, right? So we need to remedy this so that the Indian Act aligns better with the Charter. So, two court cases directly challenged the discriminatory sections of the Indian Act. Jeanette Corbet-Laval married a non-Indian in 1970 and brought action in 1971 against subsection 12, charging that it violated the Equality Clause of the 1960 Canadian Bill of Rights. We're not going to talk much about the 1960 Canadian Bill of Rights, but it was brought in by Diefenbaker. It's the forerunner to the Charter, all right? So it was never a constitutionally entrenched document like the Charter is. It lacked the teeth that the Charter has, okay? But this is the one that they challenged this particular section with, on the grounds of discrimination by reason of sex. So she lost her case at trial, but won on appeal. And the results of this case were revisited by the case of Yvonne Bedard. Bedard lost her status when she married a non-Indian in 1964. She separated from her husband and attempted to return to her reserve to live in a house inherited by her mother. She found that she and her children was no longer entitled to live on reserve, as they no longer had Indian status and couldn't inherit reserve land. All right, so you can't live here anymore. And her ban gave her a year to dispose of the property, and fearing eviction, she brought legal action against her ban. Right, the ban wanted her out. She's no longer allowed to live there, so get out of the way. Bedard won the case based on legal precedent set by the Laval case. The cases were joined in an appeal to the Supreme Court of Canada in 1973. Bedard and Lavelle lost their cases, and the marrying out rule of the Indian Act was upheld. So that's from Indigenous Foundations. But despite the result from the Supreme Court, the Bedard and Lavelle cases brought visibility to the gender discrimination of the Indian Act. The early 1970s saw major political action from both Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal women's groups to pressure the Canadian government to change the law. This action was catalyzed when Sandra Lovelace took her case challenging the Indian Act to the United Nations Human Rights Committee. Lovelace, a Maliseet woman from Tobik in New Brunswick, had married an American man and moved away from her reserve community. When the marriage ended some years later, she and her children attempted to return to her reserve to find that they were denied access to housing, health care, and education as a result of the Indian Act status provisions. Lovelace joined the political action in the early 1970s and took her case to the Supreme Court of Canada in 1974. When the Supreme Court upheld the Indian Act, Lovelace took her case before the UN, which found in 1981 Canada was in breach of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. So then in 1982, and again, here's, you know, the charter, right? The charter's now come in. The Canadian Constitution was amended to include the Charter. Section 15, this is that equality rights section that we discussed in one of the other lectures. It says that every individual is equal before and under the law, and it's the right to equal protection and benefit of the law without discrimination based on race, national or ethnic origin, equal protection and benefit, color, religion, sex, there's that, right? Age, mental or physical disability. Section 15 motivated the Canadian government to address the discriminatory sections of the Indian Act influenced by Lovelace v. Canada. It wasn't until April 17, 1985 that Bill C-31 was passed, which finally revised Indian status to address the gender discrimination in that act. Okay, so now that's a little bit more fleshed out. You kind of get how, you know, there's a long history here. It was a hard fight. Interesting too, they call these women at the top of the screen here the Indigenous Famous Five, right? I've never seen that addressed in a textbook. I've seen the Famous Five addressed in textbooks. In downtown Calgary, we have a statue to the Famous Five. There's also an identical statue that I saw when I was visiting Ottawa a few years ago of the Famous Five. But this is the Indigenous Famous Five. So this is an interesting thing that you could even investigate and talk to your students in your class about. Okay, on the importance of protecting Aboriginal rights in the Charter as exclusive rights for Native peoples, while also aligning the Indian Act so that it's Charter compliant. So this is a kind of a balancing act, folks. Like, on the one hand, right, you want your laws to be fair and equal. You don't want discriminatory laws, right? You want everybody to be treated equal, like Section 15.1 under the Charter. But on the other hand, Aboriginal peoples are a distinct group, right? They're like everyone else, but they're not like everyone else, in as much as there's this other body of the Constitution that is the treaties. Okay, so the treaties apply to them and to their relationship with Canada, and it doesn't apply to me. I mean, my family comes from Scotland, right? And any other group of people who immigrated here from Canada or to Canada, it doesn't apply to us that way. So, in other words, there are certain laws, you understand, that apply to Native people that on the surface of them, one would say, okay, well, you know, there's special rights for Native people, or there's special elements for Native people. And this is discriminatory, isn't it? Because shouldn't everyone have the same rights in Canada? Well, no. So the Charter is careful to protect the exclusivity, right? Of Native rights, which are something that they're afforded, but no one else is afforded. So you can see that here. Here's the important section out of the Charter. It's section 35, recognizing existing Aboriginal and treaty rights. So the existing Aboriginal and treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada are hereby recognized and affirmed. Like when the Charter comes in other words, these rights that they have can't be yanked from them because they're unequal, because, well, I don't have it and you don't have it and she doesn't have it, therefore how come they get it? That's no fair. Well, no, it's actually protected, okay? Land claim agreements as well. For greater certainty in subsection 1, treaty rights include rights that now exist by way of land claims, okay? And also Aboriginal and treaty rights are guaranteed to both sexes. So that speaks specifically, right, to this section of the, you know, Bill C-31 that we're talking about, the section of the Indian Act that needed to be charter compliant. Okay? So Aboriginal rights need special protection in the Charter because they are not afforded to all Canadians. I mean, think about, we've done an earlier lecture on the rights, special rights for dissentient or denominational schools in the education portion of the BNA Act. Like, just think about that and say, you know, that without that protection in the division of powers, constitutional division of powers, it would be discriminatory, right, for Canada to have special protections for Catholic schools and nobody else. Like, why can't we have Sikh schools? Why can't we have Hindu schools? Why can't we have whatever? But the point is you know, there's a constitutional protection for the special rights. This is not anything that's unusual in Canadian constitutional histories, ladies and gentlemen. We in Canada are willing to afford special recognition for special groups in special situations in the Constitution. So, problem here, but while trying to be respectful of culture and treaties and traditions, nevertheless, should all inequalities in Aboriginal traditions, say in self-government ideas, be exempt from charter scrutiny? How did Native women feel about this, right? So, this is a problem. The Charter, certain rights that Aboriginal people have, maybe they should be protected, from charter scrutiny, because, you know, they pre-exist the Charter, they pre-exist Canada, they're part of the treaties. But what about if you have a kind of a misogynistic way in which you decide who's going to run for band council, or a misogynistic sort of a way in which, band leadership is chosen, or not just even misogyny, but, you know, different sorts of things that are patently undemocratic in a democratic society. Should those certain things just be protected from charter scrutiny under the name of, well, that's Native heritage, that's Native custom, right? Native tradition. Is that okay? So there's a lot of discussion around that as well in, you know, the policy making field. So, you know, a question for you. Was the marginalization of Native women, you know, in the Indian Act solely an expression of the assimilationist policies of the Indian Act? Where else might support for marginalization of Native women be coming from? This word assimilationist, by the way, it means where you try to basically absorb everybody who might be different or distinct and make them all the same. And that's fundamentally what the Indian Act was about. It was the government's main tool to take the Indian out of the Native person, to slowly absorb and siphon away Native culture, Native identity. in Canada and just make everybody Canadian, right? So that's what that word means. But the question I have here posed for you is that solely a pressure that was exerted upon, Native women by the government? Or were there certain marginalizing forces that were coming from their own communities? And I think it's pretty clear that there were, that they were being attacked from both sides. Here's Alan Cairns in his book, Citizens Plus, an excellent book. I highly recommend it to anybody interested in the topic. The opposition of the AFN, Assembly of First Nations, right? The opposition of the AFN to Bill C-31 and its subsequent opposition to the application of the Charter to Aboriginal self-government have reinforced women's fears that self-government may not be a blessing. All right? The Assembly of First Nations is supposed to represent First Nations people all across Canada. And they're supposed to protect and advocate for First Nations people against the government, right? But here, they were opposed, not just to Bill C-31, but they were also opposed to the Charter having any application at all to Aboriginal self-government. And women's groups, were kind of leery of that. Many women in particular are fearful that self-government will not reduce the high incidence of sexual and physical abuse that now prevails in many communities. Aboriginal governments were specifically exempted from the Charter's democratic rights, which gave every citizen the right to vote in an election of members and to be qualified for membership in federal and provincial legislatures, an exemption to allow traditional practices of leadership selection for Aboriginal governments that would otherwise violate the Charter, right? So, what are the, you know, if you can protect your selection of community government from Charter scrutiny, that opens up the door to pretty bad abuses. And this is the thing that Native women's groups were particularly concerned about. So they were at odds with the AFN. A voice left out. This is the biggest group, the Native Women's Association of Canada, or the NWAC. In his testimony, AFN's National Chief David Ahenikew argued that the Indian Act should not be amended before the constitutional entrenchment of the right to self-government. First, we have to secure our right place in Canada, the rights of our First Nations. Then, we would deal with the discrimination against women by having each First Nation assume its just responsibility by determining its own citizenship. The next day, the NWAC's president, Gottfredson, argued that Aboriginal women's rights must not be kept in abeyance while Indian leaders and federal provincial governments sort out the meaning of Aboriginal constitutional rights. Like, seems pretty fair, right? We are willing to consider ban control of membership, but whatever you decide in this area, we want reinstatement first, she says. The NWAC supported Aboriginal self-government, Gottfredson asserted, but explained, if banned control of membership means Indian women must suffer under federal discriminatory legislation for another 5 or 20 years while you hash out the meaning of Indian government, we will not accept this. All right, so that's kind of an interesting little excerpt I took out of this article here, The Search for Consensus. So you can look that one up. There's the stats on it there. So, you know, there was resistance, in other words, marginalization is not, it's not a Native versus non-Native thing. It's not, I mean, it is, obviously, but it's not simply that. And to say that it is to, you know, just talk in terms of black and white. There's a lot of, it's a much more messy story than that, ladies and gentlemen. The NWAC, for example, stated, our basic position is that Indian governments determine their own membership but only after all those so entitled have been listed or relisted on their ban lists. Meanwhile, Indian bands rejected the notion of automatic reinstatement to band membership. Right, so the bands themselves, they didn't want to do what the NWAC thought would be best. The AFN maintained that it's up to the Indian governments across the country to resolve that and to put into place some just means of making sure that there is reinstatement or whatever it is they want to do. So AFN didn't want to commit anybody to doing anything. They said it's all up to the bands, let the bands handle it, you know. Whereas the NWAC wanted some action, wanted some certainty that they weren't going to just be left high and dry and people were just fighting and there was going to be this total unclear situation. So several Aboriginal groups recommended a two-tier membership system that would allow reinstatement to a general ban list while still allowing bands to decide whether to admit these individuals as band members. Crazy, right? Really bizarre stuff. States would remain under the control of the federal government, or status would remain under the control of the federal government. Indian leaders were greatly alarmed by the reinstatement proposal, angrily rejecting it in any form. "They're intruding on First Nations government's jurisdiction again. We've made that position very clear. Correct your injustices and stay the hell away from our affairs, exclaimed David Haneke of the AFN. While the NWAC asserted that DIAND, the Department of Indian and Northern... what does that even say? Anyway, their reinstatement proposal didn't go far enough to include all victims of the past Indian Act discrimination. So you can see that the NWAC didn't see eye to eye with David Haneke, didn't see eye to eye with the AFN. They were very concerned about just being continually marginalized, not just by the Indian Act itself and, you know, the historical marginalization that was going on from the government side, but even from their own communities with the male leadership. Right? The AFN did express initial opposition to the 1983 constitutional amendments protecting Aboriginal gender equality. This was on the grounds that only First Nations had decision-making authority over band membership, that any concessions to amending the law needed to be linked to recognition of self-government rights, and that equality already existed within the traditional citizenship codes of First Nations people. The agreement of the AFN to the 1983 amendments was secured in part by withdrawing federal oversight over band membership criteria. First Nations leaders claim, therefore, that it's not opposition to individual freedoms, including equality rights, that motivates their resistance to the Charter, but the non-consensual nature of its application without taking into account the needs of First Nations community. In other words, resistance is tied to the larger struggle for decolonization of Aboriginal nations. So that's going to come up again and again in our study here, folks, is this idea of decolonization, right? Things have to be done on our own terms. By our, I mean, Native people's own terms, that, any fixes or anything that happens like that, it can't be imposed upon them, it can't be on anyone else's terms but their own terms. According to the AFN, both the historical record and the Charlottetown consensus make plain that the AFN was not unalterably opposed to the application to self-government of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, as is suggested by the Court of Appeal in the NWAC case, right? So the Court of Appeal said, you guys are just being jerks, right? You're just denying the women their right to be reinstated, have their Indian status reinstated. The AFN is saying, no, that's not correct. That's not what we're doing. Rather, the AFN was opposed to the undemocratic, non-consensual imposition of the Charter without protection for First Nations languages, cultures, and traditions. So again, you know, one wonders what that even means. I mean, if you just look back at the section of the Charter that we just looked at, it seems pretty clear to me that, you know, there's concerns for First Nations language, cultures, and traditions, Section 35, right? You can go back and you can look at the various sections of the charter that apply and make your own mind up, I guess. More from this book, Beyond the Impasse. If shielding Aboriginal peoples from external encroachment of the Canadian state, including the Canadian Charter, has been an important component in the battle for sovereignty, does this suggest that Aboriginal peoples have little concern for ensuring respect for the aspirations of liberal human rights, such as gender equality, within Aboriginal governments? That's a good question, right? That was the concern of the Native Women's Association. The NWAC's opposition to constitutional entrenchment of Aboriginal self-governments was motivated by this fear. They didn't like the idea of Aboriginal self-government because they didn't know what that would mean for women. You know, could they trust all these men in the self-government positions? And given the way that Native women are, you know, abused and disaffected and not stood up for, not just by the federal government, but also it seems by, you know, the AFN, who's going to look out for them, right? NWAC was of the opinion that the Charlottetown Consensus rendered Aboriginal governments immune to the application of the Canadian Charter. And in their view, that can't be a good thing, right? The Canadian Charter, I mean, Section 15, Section 28, these things, you know, about women's rights and empowering women and, you know, these are very important, not just to, you know, all the other women in Canada, but to Native women too, right? Although supporting recognition of the inherent right to Aboriginal self-government, NWAC insisted that no government be exempt from the Charter, particularly those Aboriginal governments that are the source of patriarchal laws which created male privilege as the source, or sorry, as the norm on reserve lands. So you can see, right, there's a lot of animosity here. In this notion of self-government, you know, we want to protect the treaties, we want to honor the treaties, we want to protect Native Aboriginal First Nations Métis Inuit rights, but what does that mean? Does that protect everything? Does that protect, you know, discriminatory, harmful practices that marginalize women? Should it? These are big policy questions, folks. So the genesis of the NWAC's concerns are traceable back to discriminatory federal law introduced in 1869, which disenfranchised women who married non-Indian men, a policy of assimilation that gained the acquiescence of Aboriginal leadership in the 20th century. The discriminatory provisions in the Indian Act were subsequently repealed in Bill C-31 following the 1983 constitutional amendments, which provided that Aboriginal and treaty rights are guaranteed equally to male and female persons, and which anticipated the coming into force of the equality provisions, Section 15, of the Charter. Bill C-31 reinstated status for thousands of women and children and continues to be vociferously opposed by some bands on the basis that the federal government's amendments didn't provide sufficient resources to ensure the reentry of families onto reserve lands. Like, that's a good point, right? What, you're going to bring more people on and recognize their native status, but then you're not going to give us any more money to help have decent housing and education and health care and so forth. Like, good point, right? Affirmed by Section 35 of the Constitution Act, 1982. This has fueled further opposition by NWAC to recognition of self-government without accompanying guarantees that Aboriginal governments will be bound by the Charter. Some more on Bill C-31 Indians. What about passing along Indian status? How does this work? Well, the bill C-31 amendment has created new categories of Indian status, which renders determining one's status even more complex. One is no longer either status or non-status, maybe also either referred to as 6-1 or 6-2. Subsection 6-1 of the Act states who is eligible for Indian status. Once Bill C-31 was passed in 1985, a new subsection was created to apply to those who had their status reinstated, and to their descendants, subsection 6-2. So 6.2 states that a person is entitled to be registered if one of their parents, regardless of sex, were registered as a status Indian. That sounds all right. But what complicates this new division of 6.1 and 6.2 is the ability to pass along status. Should a status Indian under subsection 6.2 have children with a non-status person, their children are ineligible for Indian status. This is sometimes called the second generation cutoff. See, so there's still this idea that we want to make sure that we're, like, from a government perspective, that we're assimilating, right? That we're getting, that we're absorbing, you know, the Indian individual, the Indian identity is being absorbed and disappearing when there's intermarriage. A person accorded status under subsection 6.1 does not face this penalty. Interestingly, should 6.2 status Indians marry and have children, their child will become 6.1. This perpetuates the discriminatory measure of the Indian Act before Bill C-31, as certain Indians face penalties for marrying out or marrying and subsequently having children with a non-status person. While Bill C-31 made it impossible for the government to remove one's status, the government has simply created a new mechanism to serve this same purpose. The government's original objective of eventually removing Indian status entirely is still served. Bill C-31 simply deferred it a generation. So there you have an interpretation of that. You know, I guess how it's got a positive and a negative side to it, Bill C-31. Okay, what about non-status Indians? The problematic nature of status, Indian status, as created by the Indian Act, has resulted in wide-ranging implications for Aboriginal peoples ineligible for status. Aboriginal people without status under the Indian Act remain legally unrecognized as Aboriginal peoples by the Canadian government. Non-status Indians face the challenges of being legislated out of their communities, unable to participate in banned politics, and ineligible for the same rights and various types of government support offered to status Indians. However, status and non-status Indians also share many common concerns: displacement from their ancestral homelands and their traditional way of life, socioeconomic challenges, a desire to practice their own cultures and traditions, and to determine their own identities and futures. Now, I've got a question here for you, too. Are non-Aboriginal people solely responsible for excluding or denying Native people their rights? Or is that a bit of a binary, like a black and white simplification? You've probably heard from time to time, you know, news items on the radio or on TV, or you've seen them on the internet. This is one just from last year. The Gananoque couple, they were mixed, right? One person was Native, the other person was non-Native, and they married. And then people from Gananoque, they came to their house, and they were calling them all kinds of horrible, terrible names and telling them to get out. You know, graffiti, and, you know, it's really ugly, really, really ugly. It made national news for about half a week there, and then it disappeared. But I would put it to you that, you know, the situation, you know, is not, you know, an us versus them thing. You know, it's not a Native versus non-Native thing. It's not it's not so cut and dry as that, folks. There's a lot of discrimination, even within Native communities, towards other people in the community who, you know, aren't held to be, you know, truly Native or truly, you know, it's a big issue. It's very complicated, and you can just see the sort of pain that people are put through when it seems like they're being ousted by their neighbors, you know, and mistreated and you know, violently opposed, like in this particular incident. Okay, the word Eskimo. You guys probably all know that the word Eskimo is not a word we use anymore, but you'll hear it from time to time. You know, if you go down to the 7-Eleven on the hot days in the summer and you get an Eskimo pie. There's still those things. What is it? It's a Cree term for the people of the far north, meaning eaters of raw meat. The term is no longer widely accepted in Canada, but it's still used in parts of the Western Arctic. Americans still use it to speak of the native people who live in Alaska, too. The word we more properly use, folks, is the word that's in our Canadian Constitution, the word Inuit. And this word simply means the people, and its singular is Inuk. It refers to native peoples who generally live north of the tree line in Canada. Now, in his book, Collapse, excellent book, by the way, Jared Diamond writes that although today we think of the Inuit as the native inhabitants of the Canadian Arctic, really they're just the most recent in a series of at least four archaeologically recognized peoples who lived in the area over the course of nearly 4,000 years prior to the Norse arrival in Greenland. Successive waves of them spread, settled in northern territories, and then vanished, which is why they're investigated in Diamond's book on the collapse of societies throughout history. So the Inuits' immediate predecessors were a culture referred to by archaeologists as Dorset people, and they occupied most of the Canadian Arctic. Unlike the Inuit, Dorset people lacked dogs and didn't use bows and arrows. They lacked the skin boats possessed by the Inuit, which enabled them to hunt whales. And Dorset people lived in the Canadian Arctic for about 2,000 years prior to the Inuit, but were outcompeted by them technologically, and so they disappeared. I've read a little bit about Inuit technology and just how amazing these boats, these kayaks are, and how they're great big long things, and every one of them is tailor-made to the particular hunter, and just like really fantastically advanced technological prowess that the Inuit had. So it's, you know, it's no wonder in a way that the Dorset people, you know, were outcompeted and disappeared. Where Indians in Canada were treated paternalistically, or like children who need special supervision, the Inuit, or the native people in Canada's north, were wholeheartedly neglected well into the 1950s. This neglect continued even after the 1939 Supreme Court decision that said that the Inuit ought to be protected by Section 91(24) of the BNA Act. Only since 1999 have the Inuit people had the opportunity for self-government with the creation of Canada's newest territory, Nunavut. Another term, folks, the word Métis. You know, when I was a kid, I was simply taught that Métis were people who, you know, one of their parents or a grandparent or something was from European descent, and the other, typically French, right? French descent, and then the other one had Native heritage. But it was a surprise to me that actually that's not necessarily true. Métis people, or Métis, are people of mixed Indigenous North American and European descent. So not just French, but European, right? They're now constitutionally recognized in Canada as one of the official Aboriginal peoples. After New France was ceded to Great Britain's control, at one time there was an important distinction between French Métis, born of Francophone voyageur fathers, and Anglo-Métis, known as country-born, descended from English or Scottish fathers. See, I didn't know that when I was a kid. I only learned that later in life. Today, these two cultures have essentially coalesced into one Métis tradition. The Métis were, in earlier and even recent Canadian history, referred to by the derogatory term half-breeds. I think my grandpa, even though he's a dear man, he used to use that word for Métis people. Métis are most often identified as people whose descendants are both Indian and French Canadian. Métis ancestry goes back to the fur trade, when French Canadian fur traders had families with people of Native heritage. Under the law, Métis were wholly neglected by the federal government. They're often referred to as the forgotten people, and even the non-people. federal government denied any special responsibility towards them under Section 91 of the BNA Act. Métis were treated as ordinary citizens with no entitlements to the rights afforded to full Indians under the treaties. Métis, unlike Indian peoples, are given no land reserves by the federal government, nor do they have the opportunity for self-government in their own territory, as do the Inuit now in Nunavut. Indeed, most of the Métis population is spread out and dispersed in Canada's urban centers. Here's another term, folks, the term First Nations. So I took this as a direct quote out of Education is Our Buffalo on what the meaning of that is. A term used by the Assembly of First Nations to refer to their membership. In 1980, all the chiefs in Canada adopted a declaration to call their member nations First Nations because they did not like the terms Indian band or Indian tribe. The term is also used to reinforce the idea that Aboriginal people were the original inhabitants of the Americas, unquote. So here's a fun fact from Alan Cairns' book. Terms like nation and inherent right to self-government weren't used by Native people in Canada prior to the 1980s. Earlier modes of seeking to have Native rights upheld in Canada concerned traditional issues like hunting, fishing, and land and mineral rights. The term nation grew in attractiveness because of its rhetorical power in Canada. So think about the movement for Quebec separatism, right? The two nations theory and the rise of Quebec nationalism in the 1970s. This term nation is a real power-charged word, right, folks? So if you see that it's having certain, it has a certain amount of power for French people, for the Quebecois, then why not, if you're looking to get some more power in the Canadian situation as a Native person, then why not start using it yourself, right? So I'd like to inquire here. Let's investigate the meaning of this root word, nation. What is a nation? How is a nation different from a state? In what ways is the word nation used? Why is the word used? And apart from the meaning of the word, to name an aspect of reality, what is its rhetorical power? This word nation. Well, the word nation actually is Latin. Again, we looked at it. It just means really birth, origin, race, breed, stock. All right, so understand that the word nation has a kind of a blood element to it, right? At its root, it means, you know, a particular group, an ethnicity or something like that, or a race. But then you got to ask yourself, right? Well, okay, if that's its original meaning, then how does this ethnic or racial idea of nation align with Canadian identity, right? Canada's a nation, but we don't think of ourselves as a race. Like, there's something kind of creepy about that, I would say, in a place like Canada. You know, we're multicultural, right? So knowing the etymological meaning of the word nation isn't the end of the story here. Here's Ernest Renan wrote a famous essay about the meaning of the word nation. Here's a quote. A nation is a soul, a spiritual principle. A nation is a great solidarity created by the sentiment of the sacrifices that have been made and of those which one is disposed to make in the future. It presupposes a past, but it resumes itself in the present by a tangible fact, the consent, the clearly expressed desire to continue life in common. The existence of a nation is a plebiscite of every day, as the existence of the individual is a perpetual affirmation of life. So that, take that. Now think about, okay, well, does that work for Canada? And how about, does that work to in some way exemplify or embody what is meant by the word nation when you speak of First Nations? You know, First Nations, it seems, works that way, but First Nations also has that racial blood or ethnic sense to it. It's got a kind of a dual meaning, right? What about this idea of nation? Well, it links nicely with Ignatieff's distinctions concerning nations and nationalism. So I don't know how many of you know who Michael Ignatieff is. He's kind of one of these public intellectuals. He's been around for a long time. He's got a book, Blood and Belonging. He ran for and won leadership of the Liberal Party a number of years ago. He ran for Prime Minister against Stephen Harper and got his butt handed to him. And then the Liberal Party collapsed under his leadership. And ever since then, it's been rebuilding. We'll see what happens this next election, which is coming up next month. But, you know, Michael Ignatieff, he isolated two different kinds of nationalism. There's civic nationalism, which is, you know, a kind of nationalism or a sense of nation united by values, right? Who's part of the nation? People who share common values. And it's chosen, folks. It has the element of choice to it. The other component type of nationalism is ethnic nationalism. It's based on race or volk, right? It's inherited. You know, there's an in-group and there's an out-group. And you can't choose. You are or you aren't. You is or you ain't. Ethnic nationalism also can flourish within states committed to civic democracy, right? So you can have, you know, civic nationalism throughout Canada, united by values. But then within that, you can have ethnic nationalism, like, you know, a staunch kind of First Nations identity, or a staunch kind of a Quebec separatist identity, or something like that, where it's very much more rooted in race, this idea of blood and belonging. So is Canada a nation? What kind of a nation, if we are a nation? And are First Nations nations? What kind of nations, if they're nations? And what does all this have to do with the state or nation state, right? Because sometimes, you know, this is where this language leads folks, you know, to self-government, sense that, a separate order of government for First Nations people, right? So almost like a quasi-state within a state. Big questions, and you know, these words are so charged with power, and we don't often stop to think about the words that we're using and their meanings. So what makes a nation a nation? Well, the word nation can be a synonym for state. For example, the United Nations is an organization of states. But a nation isn't just a state or a group of people who share a language or a religion. For example, the Germans are not simply those who speak German language, since German is spoken in Austria, Switzerland, Luxembourg, and Belgium, right? Nor can the Germans be identified with reference to a single state, because after World War II, there were two states. It was East and West Germany. The Federal Republic of Germany didn't arise until 1990. Nor is religion the answer, since, for instance, Germans are split Protestant and Catholic. So, it's a definition then. A nation is an identity shared by a large number of people based upon, but not reducible to, objective factors such as race, language, customs, and government. So, in some way, here we are building upon or relating to that definition of nation that I just read to you from Ernst Renan. Well, let me give you a brief history of the nation. I bet you're surprised to find this when you clicked on a YouTube lecture on First Nations, but it's important to know what these words mean. So, the nation, like the participatory state, is a product of modern European history. It didn't exist in medieval Europe. People in that era thought of themselves on the one hand as Christians, or subject to the Holy Roman Empire, and on the other in terms of who was the most powerful at home, like a baron or a lord. The First Nations to emerge were the English, French, and Spanish. These nations appeared when a strong king or queen conquered land and kept it for a long time, eventually overpowering the old local lords, so that people's sense of identity broadened, becoming a wider national identity. And over time, the language that the king and his court spoke took hold throughout the land, while other local languages were suppressed. Sounds familiar? Also, the monarch's religion was made a state religion, and anyone who didn't take it on was punished or even chased out of the country. Again, sounds pretty familiar. Social differences, like money, jobs, property, education, between the nobility and common people were gradually reduced as the king took away the privileges of the aristocracy. The estates of medieval society, like the nobility, clergy, freemen, and serfs, were leveled into one category of citizens. This was often done through bloody revolutions and much killing. Nations appeared out of this often brutal use of state power. Those who went through all this history as a nation had over a long period of time become aware of themselves as a people with a common identity and destiny. Okay, so that's the meaning of nation. Is Canada a nation? Right? It sounds very different, doesn't it? And then, you know, by extension, what about First Nations people? Are they a nation? If this is what the word nation means, and its origin, and how it's, you know, it's a specific historical meaning, it's a European meaning, if this isn't in any way related to First Nations people, then, you know, but yet, and yet we use the term, it kind of has a political bent to it. It's used as a kind of a political tool here, right? So, how is it being used? What are its connotations? Those sorts of things. The French nation was created after the French Revolution of 1789. Soon after, Austria and Prussia threatened war, and the French introduced military conscription to defend themselves with a huge army of citizen soldiers. Other countries followed France's lead and developed huge armies that overran Europe, defeating the professional and mercenary armies of other states. It was the French Revolution, more than anything else, that awakened the spirit of nationality in Europe. Other people began to think of themselves as nations, even though they were not associated with a single strong state like the French or the English. Now, movements of unification began and resulted in the formation of the Kingdom of Italy and the German Empire. So, question. Is Canada a nation state? Well, the modern state is the nation state. The word nation is added to state to emphasize that the state is participatory, that it is run by and for the citizens. It's not just a power imposed on them as though they were subjects. The term nation state is problematic in Canada, so we don't use it much. A nation is a cultural reality, not a legal one. Nations are European. They don't properly exist in North America, Africa, Asia, or Australia. Nations came into existence when certain groups of people in Europe began to see themselves as different from all others because of their culture and history. Nationality wasn't just about having a common culture. Nations also must think of their territory as a permanent home, where they have worked throughout history, fought wars, built cities, roads, farmed, and where their long dead ancestors have left visible traces, such as old landmarks, artifacts, ancient buildings, etc. You know, some of that works for First Nations people, doesn't it? Maybe some of that works really well for First Nations people and doesn't work so well for Canada, does it? After a long tradition of peasant farming is a very important aspect of all nation states. So we don't have that, right? Nor do First Nations people, because they were hunters and gatherers primarily. Farming has always been the common work of the ancestors of national groups. The idea of being tied to the land is crucial for the development of a nation. Historically speaking, whenever nation states came into being, immigration ceased. This meant that peasants, agricultural workers, firmly tied to the national soil, were a prerequisite for a genuine nationality. To be more precise, nations are not so much made up of peasants as of ex-peasants, peasants who have achieved political emancipation and gone on to take control of the state from the former monarchs and aristocrats. Interesting point. So, you know, if you were to draw a Venn diagram, right, and kind of start to think, well, what the heck is Canada then? You know, is it a nation state? What? Well, there's the European nation state, and there's Canada and North America generally, and you can see that there's a kind of an overlap between the two concepts, but they aren't identical, are they? There's lots of things about Canada that simply doesn't fit the classification of a nation state. So anyway, Canadians disagree about Canada. Is Canada a binational state? Right? Is it just French and English? The part of our national mythology is that it's a binational state, right? The two founding nations, of the two nations theory, which was kind of integral to, say, the Meech-Lake Accord in the mid-1980s, right? Or, you know, even the constitutional debates at the founding of Canada. It was a binational state. Or is it made up of many different nationalities and ethnicities as a political nationality? There's a kind of a tension here. So, you know, at its beginning, it was understood by the fathers of Confederation that Canada is not a nation state, but a political nationality. The official view is that Canada is a bilingual, multicultural nation state. There's only one Canadian identity and one Canadian nation, even though internally it's pluralistic. This view can be traced back to the Confederation debates when it was spoken by Quebec's leader Georges-Étienne Cartier. Cartier called the new state of Canada a political nationality. The existence of a common government would create a national identity transcending linguistic and regional differences. These differences would continue to exist and would be reflected in provincial governments, but they would not be great enough to destroy Canada as one nation, right? So a political nationality is much different than the idea of Canada as being made up of a bunch of ethnic nationalities, right? Or ethnic nationalisms. Very, very different. The new Canadian identity, George Brown, another one of the Canadian fathers, right? For Brown and the other fathers of Confederation, neither the European model of the nation-state nor the Republican democracy of the United States served as useful examples for Canada to follow in trying to build and preserve a new and diverse nation. They concluded that Canada's foundation could not be built on a commonly held nationalism in a European mode and would not be built on one great constitutional and would not be built on a great constitutional experiment. It would maintain British connection, to be sure, but it would also resemble the U.S. Federation in being based on the low but solid foundations of economic self-interest. Since economic self-interest was largely responsible for the for bringing the fathers of Confederation and the colonies they represented together in the first place, that was a fully intelligible turn of events. Thus was born the idea of the new nationality that the Globe and Mail had praised so highly on Canada's first day. So the new nationality was very important to the Fathers of Confederation. It was a centerpiece in the speeches of Georges-Étienne Cartier and John A. Macdonald in the Canadian legislature in February 1865 when the Confederation scheme was being debated. One of the greatest opponents of Confederation was Antoine Aimé Dorion, leader of the Parti Rouge of Canada East. He claimed that the creation of this new nationality meant that French-Canadian culture would be lost, right? He felt like, you know, this would absorb, it was designed to absorb French culture, the French race from North America. Dorion thought that race, language, religion, and culture must be pure in order to have a strong country. He opposed the idea of confederation because it would allow people from all different backgrounds to live together, and this would endanger the identity of French Canadians. All right, so not every, like, even back then, this idea of ethnic nationalism, you know, that what distinguishes me is my race from all other people. That this was even there even then, and it was a very strong force. As Cartier pointed out, it's lamented by some that we had this diversity of races, and hopes have been expressed that this distinctive feature would cease. The idea of unity of races was utopian. It was impossible. Distinctions of this kind would always exist. Unquote. The new nationality was created for economic purposes. Race was entirely besides the point in Cartier's view. In fact, Cartier thought that the idea of a Canadian race was extremely dangerous and had no place in Confederation. I think probably most of us share Cartier's sentiment even to this day in Canada. So, if race, language, religion, and culture aren't the way we define our national identity, then what ties us together as Canadians? We as Canadians don't have any great myths that tie us together. At our beginnings, the only myths that unified us were the stories of making a new life together and the ties of commerce and making money. The role of the new national state in fostering a new nationality was to promote economic growth and national development. The fathers of Confederation knew that the state could never have any other role. That is one reason why the federal government was given no powers over what we now call cultural matters, or over education. This is also why the national government was given the greatest powers over commercial and economic matters. So in Canada, not national myths, but individual and collective self-interest was to be the glue that would hold us together as a nation, I guess. So Georges Etienne Cartier strongly disagreed with Dorion's view that race, language, and culture of a country have to be pure, right? He was really dead set against that. Against Dorion, Cartier spoke. Nations were now formed by the agglomeration of communities having kindred interests and sympathies. Such was our case at the present moment. Has the diversity of race impeded the glory, the progress, the wealth of England? In our own federation, we should have a Catholic and Protestant, English, French, Irish, Scotch, and each by his efforts and his success would increase the prosperity and glory of the new confederacy. Unquote. So Cartier's political nation would indeed gain legitimacy among all the constituent ethnic groups as well as among the suspicious colonial politicians, because kindred interests and diversity of many kinds would all benefit from the enhanced prosperity that the new nation promised. By emphasizing what the communities and individuals had in common, rather than what divided them, Cartier's prudence turned a potentially destructive action into a win-win achievement. All sides benefited and no one was shortchanged. The new nationality would hold together out of self-interest and the mutual support of disparate groups in the common enterprise of what we now call nation building. Keep all this in mind when you're thinking about native peoples. Cartier showed that Canada would be a better country if it was full of all sorts of people from different cultures and backgrounds. He showed that even with all our different races, religions, language, and culture, we can be stronger by helping each other succeed. This new nationality couldn't be created in Canada without consent. Consensus is the basis for how we decide to live peacefully together. In order to get everyone's consent so that the new nationality could be created, different groups in Canada wanted certain things. For instance, Ontario and English-speaking people wanted Canada to expand westward so that there could be more trade and opportunities for making money. And two, French-Canadian-speaking people wanted to make sure that Quebec could always be a national homeland for them. And three, everyone wanted economic development so they could make a good living. And four, nobody wanted anyone in Canada to wreck this balance of demands, either by trying to turn the English and French people into single people with a single identity, or by imposing the will of the one on the other. Okay, so it's kind of a balancing act. And you can see how strongly the French-English two nations theory figured at the beginning of the Canadian Confederation here, right? There's no mention of three founding nations, namely Native people. Fathers of Canadian Confederation thought that the Americans relied too much on the power of their own ideas and arguments, on reason more than on tradition, and on strong faith in Republican virtue, the idea of self-sacrifice for the good of one's country. All right, so where the American Constitution was more stressed on ideas, the Canadian Constitution has its founding more in practicality. It was more like a business deal. This is David Berkison, the famous historian. This is more his take on it. It wasn't an abstract thing like the American founding. It was more of a business deal. So as part of this consensus, when Canada was created, all the Fathers of Confederation silently promised compromise, not to ask abstract questions about the new nationality. For example, nobody asked whether the French and the English were to have equal rights in the West. The Fathers of Confederation assumed that the English and the French, Protestant and Catholic, would probably never agree on what should be taught in the schools. So they didn't seek consensus about these things. But they were very interested in working together to sustain national prosperity so that everyone who came to Canada could earn a living and have a good life. That was enough for them. The Canadian Confederation was very much like a business deal that was meant to benefit everyone. So that sounds pretty good, doesn't it? But what about how all this affected Native people in Canada? All this nation-building stuff is about French and English people, right? It's about white dudes. So I've got a few points here, right? After that big, long investigation of the meaning of the word nation. What about economic benefit for everyone? Economic self-interest? Whose, right? I mean, French and the English in Canadian Confederation were pretty good at looking out for themselves and thinking that French and the English or the two nations theory encapsulated pretty much everybody, but it sure did it. What about a nation has citizens, right? Well, yeah, nations have citizens. They're not, you know, this is. But what about wards of the state? That's what Native people are classified as under the Constitution. So they're not really citizens. They're wards of the state. Almost like subjects, really, although it's slightly different. But and the idea of race has no place in the new nationalism, does it? Or nation of Canada. But what about how Indians are listed as being under the jurisdiction of the federal government in the Section 91? Well, if there's no place for race, why are Native people singled out? Why is the race of Native people, of Indians, singled out when the new nationalism isn't supposed to, you know, do that? See, there's some complexity here, right? Depending on who's telling the story, then there's these holes. Cartier mentions English, Irish, French, and Scotch, but what about Native people? Each by his efforts and his success would increase the glory and prosperity of the new Confederacy. Well, I mean, how's that worked out for Native people? Not so much. And the new Confederacy was supposed to be about protecting minorities from being assimilated. Right? Oh, well, we don't want the French to feel like they're going to be assimilated, and we don't want the English in Quebec to feel like they're going to be assimilated. Well, what about the Native people? Like, that's the whole thing behind, you know, the Indian Act is assimilation, right? That's like, do you understand, right? That I mean, this is the suspicion that I'm asking you to bring to the use of these terms. So these are really powerfully charged terms. They're weapons. The term is, you know, native or you know, state or nation. These terms all have kind of power and rhetorical force to mobilize support for ideas. They create winners and they create losers. Words are powerful tools to carve out a national identity, create a state, or to undo or subjugate another people. So they can be used. Words, nation, and state can be used as weapons, right? The word nation and state can also be used in a strategic way. Many people want to be nations because being a nation is seen to be sufficient to acquire a state. In Canada, we speak of First Nations, and the legislature of Quebec is called the National Assembly. These groups wish to be addressed as nations in order to get recognition and special consideration from the state. By asking to be referred to as nations, they're not chiefly concerned with how the state affects all citizens, but rather with using the law to protect and defend what they identify with their own nation. This use of the term nation has become a major problem in Canadian politics. Indeed, confusion about the relationship between the rule of law and the groups which claim to nationality, whether Aboriginals, Quebecers, or others, is at the heart of our recent constitutional problems. Quote from Cooper's book here, Berkison and Cooper's book. One thing at least was clear to our 19th century predecessors. The European model of nation-state and European understanding of nationalism could have no place in Canada. That was the real reason why Cartier spoke of Canada as a political nation. So, I mean, these words, just impress upon when you're teaching your students, you know, if it's high school or wherever, just impress upon them how their use of words can hurt or heal, how their use of words can show respect or disrespect. You know, how they're tools and weapons too, right? When you get into high school in particular, you can talk, you know, with some nuance about how, you know, we can use words strategically as well. Okay, that was a long introduction to terminology, folks. I hope that the next lecture on Native rights will, or Aboriginal policy will inspire you. It'll give you some good background as to, what has led to the problems that we see now in Aboriginal education and some of the misconceptions that people have in the rest of Canada who are non-native, who don't have any understanding of the issues that people face in those communities. All right. Thank you for listening.